All right, everyone, welcome back. My name is Matt Zefferman. I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Defense Analysis, the Naval Postgraduate School. Someone's supposed to introduce me. I'll introduce myself. It's me.
Good job, Sam.
I should say I'm attending this meeting in my personal capacity, not as a representative of the U.S. government. So the views are my own. They do not represent the Naval Postgraduate School, the Department of the Navy, the Department of Defense, or any other government or federal agency. And my talk today is problems with comparing groups using instruments designed for one, and we'll talk. So 3 years ago, when I first got invited here, I didn't really have any science of science type things to talk about. And I told Aaron that, and he said I could come and hang out and ask questions and learn. But since then, I kind of developed this project. And the kind of thoughts behind this are, I'm a math modeler. I'm making simple models to answer questions that are confusing. And I did get an opportunity in a postdoc to go do basically 6 months over 2 years of field work in West Africa with Turkana pastoralists, examining whether or not and how they may have combat trauma and combat stress due to the amount of warfare they engage in. I'm not talking about today, but what I'm going to talk about is kind of this type of project that I was involved in is was made to kind of address as an example of addressing something called a weird problem. And mostly in psychology and behavioral economics. Now, WEIRD is a clever acronym. It stands for Western, Educated, Industrialized, Rich, and Democratic. And the idea here is that we have all these instruments, psychological instruments, or behavioral economics instruments, experiments, surveys, things like that. And we measure WEIRD populations, which are primarily undergraduate students at Western universities. And then we take the findings, or people take the findings, and then they just say, make broad pronouncements about human nature or how people behave that you apply to everybody in the world, right? And this is becoming a better known problem. Still, not a lot has been done about it, my study aside. But the way that this is being addressed is kind of similar. You take these kind of instruments, instead of just measuring one population, you kind of go out to lots of different populations, and ideally the most different from kind of a Western United States, the better. And you kind of perform these measurements on different groups, and then you can make comparisons, right? You can say there's a lot of variation across societies and groups in these measurements, and we can start talking about the comparison. So I'm going to talk about, I think this is great, but I'm going to talk about one little wrinkle in here, which is something I've been thinking about a lot, which is the fact that these instruments, although we're applying them to lots of different populations, we're all mostly still developed by weird populations for weird populations. And so you have this cycle where researchers kind of have some intuitions about something that might be going on in psychology based on introspection or interactions with other people in their society. They develop these instruments and then they refine these over time in kind of iterative process where they're looking like statistical properties of the instruments, whether they're capturing the things they do. They argue about things you do PCAs or you do factor analysis, and you start to try to make these instruments where you get the most information out of them or the things you think you're trying to measure with the least number of questions. And I handed out a kind of instrument that you, some of you have looked at and some of you have not. That's fine. You can do that on your own time. But then you take these instruments that are developed and optimized for one group, and you're applying it to the other group to then making comparisons. So kind of the general question I've been kind of asking myself, and I spent a lot of time looking at the kind of history of how combat stress and PTSD research developed, is what kind of biases might this put into our data? And I'm not the first person to look at this type of question, maybe from a math modeling standpoint, but there's folks medical anthropologist Alan Young wrote a really great book about the social construction of combat stress, how it developed through the psychological field in the United States. And then the cross-cultural psychologists think a lot about this, and there's a lot of great work where they try to, instead of coming with a preconceived instrument, they kind of do more ethnographic work and try to figure out how people perceive trauma in their own society. And so I've been collecting examples of places where people do these comparisons and under certain contexts. And I'm gonna talk about one today, which Andrea already brought up, which is great. It saved me some time in explaining it, which is this male variability hypothesis. And this is, there's a great kind of review of the history of this from 1982. That I'm going to put up here in case anyone is interested. But this is the basic idea of the null variability hypothesis. And this comes from a 2009 paper in PNAS. And the idea is that, there was this kind of issue with people that thought that males were just going to be smarter than females, especially at the top end. Whereas when people started developing these instruments where they try to measure intelligence, the scores weren't that different between males and females, right? And so what came out of it is this idea that it's like, well, yeah, the mean or essential tendency might be similar. And this comes before people were really even looking at this in distributions, but it's like in the tails that really matter. And we were especially in this like right tail. And the idea there is like, if males have more variability, even though mean is better, this area that Paul tells me is like an orange red, is where all the geniuses and people hang out. And so you can explain why, you know, for example, there are more men in prestigious research universities in certain fields is because they're just in that like far end of the distribution. As a side, Simon Dedeo, who's like an SFI person, has an interesting blog post where he actually questions whether that's true, whether the top researchers are actually in that part of the distribution, which is a different question, but this is this kind of the general gel variability hypothesis. And this comes up in the news. In 2005, Larry Summers ended up resigning over a talk he gave where he, this is one of the reasons why he said he felt that women were potentially underrepresented in certain fields at certain prestige levels in universities. And a few years later, there was a Google employee who wrote a memo questioning women in technology and whether there should be any kind of research into why there aren't more women in the tech sector. But he ended up getting, there was a big controversy. He ended up getting fired from Google for coming up. So even today, it comes up, even though this idea is surprisingly old when I started looking into this. I found out about it like on a tweet that I saw about this male variability hypothesis. I hadn't heard of it before. But then when I started looking into it, it actually goes back, like a lot of things. That should be 1887, not 1987. There's a couple lines in Darwin. So everyone likes to find something in the Darwin book to justify their beliefs. There's a couple lines where he mentions that he thinks that males might be more variable in certain characteristics of females in the descent of man. But the person who really brought this to the fore, Havelock Ellis in 1895. And this is just gonna be a thumbnail sketch. Just people have been writing about this stuff for 100 years, but this is a thumbnail sketch of history. And he was looking at physical characteristics, but also mental characteristics. And his thing was that like, hey, if you look at a bunch of mental institutions, there are a lot more males than females in the mental institutions. So that's like the low end of the curve. But also if you look at these lists of famous men in many, or sorry, famous people in many fields, the vast majority of them are men, right? And so that's the top end of the curve. And so his argument is that there just seems to be this variability distribution. And there was this, Sir Francis Galton started this whole thing of like making lists of prominent people. And you know he was referring to the overrepresentation of men on the list. Carl Pearson makes a cameo in here to argue that one, if you measure a bunch of other things on physical traits, females are more variable than males in certain things. And also the kind of evolutionary ideas that Havelock Ellis was putting out actually don't fit well with evolutionary theory, which is where if things are under selection, you tend for them to get less variable, which is still a good statistical argument to make from an evolutionary standpoint. So he was arguing with him on evolutionary and statistical grounds. The next kind of, I'm setting up this versus, there's other people involved in these debates, but Edward Thorndike, who was a psychologist in 1910, wrote a book where he argued specifically about mental traits, that there was a lot more variability in males and females, again, trying to account for the overrepresentation of males in elite fields. And there's this paper by Lida Hollingsworth in 1914, which I love this paper. She's on fire, and she makes a lot of statistical arguments. I like to, because she's just making like simple models to explain something, right? And she argues that, you know, variability and mean central tendency doesn't matter much. Like you can change the variable, the fatness of the tails a little bit, you can get very different answers. So variability doesn't necessarily tell you much about the tails, but she also makes a lot of other arguments in this paper, which I highly recommend. Okay, next stage, order one happens. And we'll talk about this a little bit more. All of the research that people are devoting to like figuring out male differences and female differences in IQ gets devoted to the war effort. And people stopped writing about this for a long time. And it's not really until 1936 that you get, it's not really a meta-analysis because it's not latent enough in the time to have a meta-analysis, but do a review of a bunch of papers where they can look at sex differences in variational tendency in different studies. And for most of them, it's pretty inconclusive. Things aren't significant. There's huge selection biases in who takes the test that are concerning. The kind of the two places where there is a strong signal of higher male variability are these tests that were developed by the Army in World War I, when they're applied to mixed gender groups, and this survey of Scottish children in 1933, which I'll mention briefly at the end, but that's kind of like the gold standard study that people always cite that are
favor of the male variability hypothesis.
I'm talking a little about the army test because this is going to be important to the model I'm going to present. The army test in World War One, Robert, I don't know how to say Yerkes, president of the American Psychological Association, convinced the War Department that, hey, we can put psychology to the use of the war effort. And how we're really going to do that is we're going to go out and assess all of those people that we are drafting into the military, all people being almost entirely male that we're drafting into the military, and be able to assign them to proper roles, leadership roles, or being a cook, or being an infantry person, et cetera. And this is, we're going to create like this literal army of psychologists to go out and do this measuring. And this is the first company of the commissioned psychologists that were involved in this effort. And so what they did is they went out to all these different recruitment set and enlistment areas and commissioning areas and gave tests. So this is 1917, a group of men taking the test. This is a group of Black or African American men taking the test. And these were segregated test-taking facilities. And one nice thing about these tests is there is a lot written about the process of making and forming tests. These are three books from over 3 years, and it's about 1,300 pages of riveting reading. If you'd read this, this came out on the test. So this is from the Army test that they gave to all these recruits. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to present kind of a model of the test generating process for these Army tests that, again, are these ones that have this really high signal of male variability. And so to do this model, I'm going to see, okay, there's this universe of possible questions, very large universe of possible questions. And that's because psychological traits, there's many, many dimensions on which you can measure them, almost an infinite number of dimensions. But these questions have statistical properties. They have kind of like a baseline difficulty, how hard they are in general. And then there's a, you know, kind of a domain specific difficulty for males and females. Males and females are just socialized differently and learn different things, especially at this time. And there's possible the different questions might just be harder or easier for the different sexes. And one thing I just want to point out is there's no difference in the distributions. There's just a difference in the question, but they're being drawn from the same distribution. And then for each question in the universe, there's some probability that a male answers it correctly. And this is just a logistic regression done backwards. And then there's a probability that the female answers it correctly, right? So this depends on both the baseline difficulty and how difficult it is male or female. I didn't do a dummy variable with this because I wanted to make sure everything is symmetric between males and females. There's no innate difference at this level between the two. One thing is, if you do a lot of reading of these in this era of psychological assessing, there's this really people really, really want things to be normally distributed at the end, right? And there's debates about whether things are actually normally distributed in the real world, and it's like really hard to have the debate because who even knows, but they really, you know, this is like the ideal test curve for everyone, is that it's normally distributed, and that's the way it goes. And then if you look at like how people decided to revise the test, you know, so they would design a test, give it to a bunch of smaller populations of mostly male recruits or males at elite universities. And then they revise the test. And some of the criteria they used is that they really wanted the test to match the opinions of the training officers, both because they thought that was a good measure of how good a quality a recruit is, but also because they want buy-in from the military to say like, oh yeah, this is a good way to assess people because it matches our preconceived notions already. And they wanted not too many easy and hard questions. So at the parts of the distribution where almost everybody gets it right or almost everybody gets it wrong, there's a tendency to remove those questions and add questions that are more at the 50-50 point, which kind of makes sense a little bit because you can get a lot more discrimination around there. It's where the most variability is and potentially the most information is. But that's just kind of part of the standard process. And that's clear when you read through this. And this is just some more examples of that. They also, the only time in this reading they really mentioned women in their description of the production of the test is saying that as a rule, women tend to object to the information in the test because it involves a lot of technical things about sports. But they didn't notice that there wasn't much difference in the means. And so they didn't think it was that important. They didn't really look at the variance when they made for this comment because they weren't really that interested in women, but this was the only reference in all those thousands of pages to women taking the test. All right, so we have that. And these are all going to be clues that go into the model. And so the test construction process, I just modeled it like this. And what this basically is that the probability of out of this universe of questions that one gets selected is On average, things that tend to have more variance in the answer, meaning they're closer to 50-50, tend to get picked a little bit more on average. And the strength of that is this alpha term. So if alpha is zero, there's no bias. Questions are just picked at random. If it's higher, then if it's super high, then you just pick the ones that are everything's a 50-50. So you can kind of adjust the bias there. And we'll look at how that changes things. Does anyone have any questions as I'm going on? Okay. And then from this, in the models, so we're doing the model now, some number of questions are picked. And I think that in the models I'm gonna present, there was a million questions here. And then we ended up with a test of 200 questions, which is about the same size as the Army test. Okay, and so that's modeled the test construction process. Now we're gonna do a test taking process. So I'm gonna simulate having, I think this was 1,000 people take the test. The people are gonna have this kind of, there's things besides knowledge about that might be gender specific that people might influence their test taking abilities. So each person is going to get their own, how good are you taking tests for? And this makes a big difference here because a lot of people who have taken this test have never taken a test before. There's descriptions in those documents about like a large number of people who have never like held a pen or pencil in written before. So there's a huge variance in like how good people are taking tests. And I'm purposely not calling this intelligence because I do think there is like, when you practice taking tests, if you could take tests, you guys all probably did pretty well in this test considering it's a 100-year-old test because you guys have probably taken more tests than most of the people that did take this one. And they also had a separate test for people who were functionally illiterate, which I'm not gonna talk about today because it's a simple model. And then, so all this really does is just adds a term for each individual, taking each question, like how is their skill? So again, it's just a slightly more complicated logistic regression in reverse. Okay, so here's the results. So if you do this, you apply this to males and females, you end up with a curve that looks like this. And this is just setting all the parameters to one. And I'll show you with different parameters, but you end up with, I think this is the blue one here is males, have less variance and they're higher up in the tails than females. And it's not because there was any innate difference in intelligence, all these distributions are the same, it was just in the test taking process, you kind of were dividing the test to increase variance in male scores. And so it's not surprising that when you apply it to a bigger population, I mean, to me anyway, which is why I did the model, when you apply it to a bigger population, then you'll find more variance in male scores than a different population in female scores. That's basically the idea of all. And you can change the parameters around. You can set things at zero or double them, and you get kind of this, you get different shapes, but kind of the same general answer. And there are two cases where you get basically the same distribution, and that's when there's really no gender-specific knowledge. So if you set the gender-specific knowledge term to zero, or if you're not doing any selection, you're just picking questions at random, which kind of makes sense. And I like in Andre's study, one reason I'm focusing on these early tests is because there's this general sense, and I guess you have good empirical data now, that this effect decreases over time. From the model, two reasons why it might decrease over time is maybe there's less educational differences between males and females than there were in the early 20th century. And also test design is just getting better. The types of questions you might have seen on this test probably are not going to be asked as much as they are now. And also some tests I think normalize for gender as part of the test design. So that should eliminate that difference. The Scottish test, which I also had mentioned, I don't have as much data on like who it was tested on. I do know they did a lot of removing high and low scores. And I do have a history of the test it was based on and those were based on. I have like a meeting with the archives that have Sir Godfrey Thompson who designed this test papers to try to figure out, like if I could get information. So to be determined, but if it was in fact tested on probably in predominantly male groups, it would kind of be another example of this. The next model I'm gonna do, which actually the original one I did is a model of eugenic bias in test design. So some of you may be aware that eugenics was very popular at the turn of the 20th century. At the top levels of science. Robert Yerkes, who was at the time a colonel in the military, he was the one who pushed to have these tests designed and is, like I said, the former president of the American Psychological Association. In this 1923 kind of analysis of the results of this said, there's a million quotes I could put in here, but said that, this is in the introduction to this, that the author of the study in his careful analysis critical re-examination and discussion of Army data concerning the relations of intelligence to native nativity and length of residence in the US. In a recently published book, this other author has pointed to lessons of history of our nation and has argued strongly for purebred races. And he sees that this also argues strongly for having purebred races in the United States. He says it behooves us to consider the reliability and the meaning of the findings here, for no one as a citizen can afford to ignore the menace of race deterioration and the evident relations of immigration to national progress and welfare. So there's this big like push to take some findings from here where they're looking at across ethnic group data and applying it to the United States immigration policy. And there's lots of quotes in here. I'm not gonna read them all, but basically you have this idea that the Nordic race is the most superior intellectually, and you should not mix with other Southern European races or with African American groups. And there's just like pages and pages of this in the book. So there's a really strong eugenics argument here, and they produce figures where it's like different groups, racial groups are kind of ranked by how well they did on this army test in the army. And so I personally think there's potential in here either. Probably consciously, but also subconsciously biased for like, we're going to design a test that's going to, the whole point of this test is to rack and stack people for where they should be in the army. We have strong biases. The researchers are all of Anglo-Saxon or Nordic descent. It's possible that they are referring questions that would rank people with their kind of background and experience higher than people without. So I built a more complicated model. Essentially, the only difference really is that there's a separate term in aggression for ethnic group, which is either, I put here white or non-white. And then for interaction term. The same type of process, except now the bias is for favors questions where white males would do better than non-white males, and there's an effect strength there. Apply the test to a population of mixed sexes and ethnicities, and did some results. Baseline results across the board, you have normal distribution, which is the goal of these studies. Looking at gender differences, it still creates this gender variance difference. And this is everything set at one. This can get bigger or lower with different parameter values. This is because when you're doing this eugenics thing, you're pushing the male variance higher. But because you have this interaction term, the female variance is not going to push this far out. So just this like putting in this eugenics without trying to select for middle variability still does this because you're increasing variability in males. And I'm colorblind, so I'm going to do my best here. But from left to right, when you break it out by ethnicity and sex, this is non-white males, non-white females, white females, non-white males, non-white females, white females, white males. And so there are some predictions here that I haven't been able to find the data to look at this, but if you were to take this test and you broke it out by ethnicity and sex, you would find that actually at the female level, there'd be less difference in scores than at the male level based on ethnicity. So that's a prediction of the model that I haven't looked for, but could possibly be there. So in that sense, non-white females would do better than non-white males, even if the mean for everyone's the same. Okay, so the take-home messages for this are, this is kind of, I see like an example, and I have other studies I want to do with different things. Paul has a complicated paper to me about personality traits, and I think there might be a similar message here for personality traits. But the take-home tech message, the general message is measuring multiple populations and across populations using instruments that were kind of optimized and designed for what might create systematic biases in the results of these kind of cross-cultural comparisons. And specifically, this might account for this higher male variability in test scores, especially back at the turn of the 20th century, which seems to be decreasing to today. And with that, I will take questions. Thanks. You mentioned the test that some of you looked at. So there's this argument that like these IQ tests, even at this time, did not rely on domain-specific information, which means like just knowledge about the world, that they're general tests of intelligence. These are two subtests from the test that I think if you've taken them or read through them, you might think there might be some domain-specific knowledge in there. For example, I'm not sure how many of you knew that there's a reason as a advertising slogan was for Posthume, which is a drink that was, I guess, advertised in the 1910s. You might think the people who would read periodicals or see advertisements in certain contexts with Posthume, and other people might not. For example, like I don't know if this test had it, but there's a lot of different versions of these tests, but a lot of them have questions that are kind of like proxies for like, how much do you trust the police, right? And so you might think that from an ethnic, and even second, from both the ethnic side and from the gender side, there might be, you know, reasons why there'd be differences in how much you trust the police there. And that's, yeah, Aaron.
So this is great, really interesting, clear, very, very clear. It makes me think in terms of trying to translate it back to the science of science, that, you know, we see something similar in the way that we evaluate scientific contributions, right? Citation counts and productivity counts. And those things, I mean, I work in computer science where we publish a ton of papers and other fields publish many fewer. So in some sense, like, we already know to some degree that these measures of research sort of amounts and so on are biased by the community, right? That we need to correct for the fact that there are different practices in the different communities that are part of science. But I think it also says that there's potential, like, in order to really understand what it means to produce research in a given community, we need to understand that community's norms and procedures in the context that they design them, and then try to take that and turn it into some sort of measure. So yeah. I just want you to hear you sort of speak about that.
Throughout yesterday's talks, and this isn't like a knock on anybody, it does like bother me when it's hard in a sense because I don't like disciplines, but it's also being around like SFI and just be going a lot of interdisciplinary things, like disciplines are just very different, right? And I think that most of us know that more than people that are within a discipline. And it does bother me when you see analysis that's not broken up by discipline, because you can get a lot of very different effects if things are broken up by disciplines. Because if disciplines are different sizes, if you're looking at gender stuff, there's different ratios of males and females, et cetera. And so it's like really hard to come with specific things. So I do agree with that. I think that in promotion and hiring, we kind of do that. I think where it gets harder is because people that are doing promotion and hiring kind of know the discipline, but that's where it becomes tricky is when you have people that are, for example, I have a lot of friends who are anthropologists by training that are in psychology departments. And in psychology, you can just do like a million, no offense to psychology, you can just do a million experiments and they're kind of cheap. Because you just do it for course credit, and there's a million undergraduates in course credit. And so you just, the thing is, people just publish a lot. The statistical methods are not super, because their experiments are not super hard, so people just generate pubs. But if you're an anthropologist in a psychology department, it's hard to evaluate, because you might be publishing one or two articles a year, because it's just the cost of doing the research is just so much higher. And so I do agree that if you're trying to like generalize across academic fields, it's really tricky if you're looking at disciplines. And whether people give talks to get credit, or whether they write papers or they write books. I mean, those are just very different metrics.
Yeah. Going off Aaron's question, it reminds me of kind of a test, like an imbalance in the class labels in a training set. So I wonder what happens if, instead of having like no women in this like initial stage, there's like a small minority of women and you're kind of sampling from that population. And then you're like extending it to the broader population. Because in science, it seems like a lot of the criteria are based on just everyone. But then if the field is like mostly men, then perhaps you end up with the same sort of effect where in the tails, there's more men, because when you train this process on everyone, there's more noise with the minoritized group.
That's a good point. I hadn't really thought about it in science, just like that, but you can imagine some of the things that people have been talking about standards around having children and things like that, might be an example of that, where you're applying, a bunch of males applying standards, but then maybe once you get a certain threshold or a certain number of female evaluators, that's the ability to take into account people's child rearing, is more important. Yeah, I don't know. I haven't really thought about that hard, but that could be analogous. Yeah.
Andre. I'm sorry. Cassie, you want to
go ahead?
I was just curious. So in our meta-analysis, the majority of the tests we included are Wechsler variants and Ravens, right? What is the relation between the Army developed tests and these more modern ones? Do they still do the kind of thing that you were mentioning the Army was doing, where based on men's responses, you pick the things that will increase variability?
I don't know. I've been meaning to try to do like a phylogenetic tree of tests.
Yeah.
I do know that like tests are like, in the US, this is like the core test, and a lot of tests that were developed took types of questions and things from it and then like changed a little bit over time. I don't, that refinement process as you go through the time, I don't have detailed information on that, though I have a ton of papers in a folder.
I think it's also going to be hard because it's proprietary.
That's where I That's another reason I can focus on this, I have thousands of pages. But
yeah.
I have tried looking at the modern tests and I couldn't find detailed information because some company made them, right? So, and
yeah,
so
it's really annoying.
Yeah. So I imagine it's annoying for you too, but I haven't been able to figure it out. Yeah.
Just a really quick comment, but in relevance to the highly skilled workforce, Nathan Ensminger makes a really interesting argument that the introduction of entrance tests into computer science is what was both a strategy and an explanation for the massive decline in women in that field. And so, but he didn't go into the kind of detail that you did, but I think it'd be really relevant here. And then particularly working into industry hiring now and the changing forms of interviews there, which require sort of quasi tests and demonstration of work, which may favor certain skills and attributes of genders and races, I think are really relevant here. So I think this is fantastic work and like bringing it into sort of the composition of the highly skilled workforce generally. I think there's some other good points that can be picked up.
Right. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I'll do the rest for you later.
Yeah.
All right, let's give Matt another round of applause.